This video is sponsored by Squarespace, for when you need a website for your independent business or band. The UK single chart used to mean something. Now, not so much. But before the age of streaming, a number one single was an achievement to be proud of. Especially when the artist wasn't your stereotypical pop act. Many influential acts have never reached the chart's apex, not even close. But yet Pink Floyd, Iron Maiden, The Clash, Arctic Monkeys, and the Manic Street Preachers have taken the top spot. Should I stay or should I go now? With rock always stuck in the shadow of pop supremacy, there's a sense of accomplishment in the face of impossible odds. But rarely, if ever, has a number one single captured a moment in history as concisely as The Specials did in 1981. The band's legacy is audible in artists as diverse as Operation Ivy, Massive Attack, The Streets, The Prodigy, and Lily Allen. But with their second number one single, The Specials managed to capture the malaise of the British public, the strain of unemployment, and the tensions of cultural unrest. This is New British Canon, and this is the story of Ghost Town. The Specials started in Coventry in the British Midlands in 1977. The first stable lineup of the group consisted of vocalist Terry Hall and Neville Staple, guitarist Limble Golding and Roddy Radiation Byers, bassist Horace Panter, drummer John Bradbury, horn players Dick Cuffell and Rico Rodriguez, and keyboardist and mastermind Jerry Dammers. Growing up in multicultural Coventry, the Specials lineup consisted of both white and black musicians, a rarity at the time. Said Dammers, "For me, it was no good being anti-racist if you didn't involve black people. So what the Specials tried to do was create something that was more integrated." Their music was an extension of this. Equally inspired by the UK punk scene of the late 1970s, as well as by Jamaican ska music from the 60s. It was a powerful new sound, and the nation's youth soon latched onto it. Punk was dying, the Sex Pistols had split, the charts were full of second division punk bands, and people were after something new. We were in the right place at the right time, and we had the tunes. The Specials' first single, Gangsters, was released in May 1979. It was a punkier reworking of Prince Buster's 1964 ska classic, Al Capone. With the original's wordlessness traded for the nasal wail of Hall, and the gruff toasting of Staple. It was released on their own independent label called Two Tone. The name was inspired by their multi-genre and multicultural synergy. The label's trademark monochrome checks showing black and white peacefully coexisting beside each other. Despite being an independent release, Gangsters reached number 6 in the UK charts. With this brought new acts on Two Tone, including Madness, The Selector, and The Beat, all creating new spins on the ska punk formula set out by The Specials. The 8th of November 1979 episode of Top of the Pops would feature performances from three of those acts, showcasing a new direction in British rock music, separate from the post-punk and new wave acts of the time. Over the next 2 years, The Specials released two albums, becoming one of the biggest bands in Britain in the process, but their defining statement would arrive in May 1981. The Specials were at a turning point in their career. On their preceding album, More Specials, the punked up ska was still present in part. But Jerry Dammers had taken influence from easy listening Muzak keys and rhythms. Not only was this not what the majority of the band wanted to be doing, but it also confused their audience. The next release would be the Ghost Town EP. Its Dammer's Pen title track incorporated discordant horns, haunted chords, and demonic vocal harmonies for something decidedly not easy listening. The overall sense I wanted to convey was impending doom. The song's subject matter was inspired by the economic depression that the band was seeing as they toured the UK. Local businesses closing down, joblessness, and a rise of violence at their shows. While previously the band had written about nightclubs as a poor excuse for escapism, I won't dance in a club like this. Even this was being taken away. Said Staple, all the places we used to rehearse in and play our early gigs, they were shutting down. The place mentioned to be closing down in Ghost Town is the Locarno, which is also mentioned on EP track Friday Night, Saturday Morning. I'm going to watch my money go at the Locarno now. Dammers recalls in Glasgow seeing two old women on the street selling their cups, saucers, and plates. Such were the financial issues facing the country.
You know, Margaret Thatcher was busy closing down huge swathes of British industry because they weren't profitable. She was like Al Capone, I would guess, because her mob weren't getting paid, she was going to shut them all down. So that's what happened, and we were touring the country, and we could literally see it happening.
The National Front movement was blaming this unemployment and economic depression on the immigrant population of the UK, and the racist skinheads that supported the movement started making trouble at shows of the multiracial specials. Bands won't play no more. Too much fighting on the dance floor. This line references the fact that the violence at their shows was getting to the point that the band had decided to quit touring. To further make the immigrant population of Britain on edge, the police were employing stop and search tactics on minorities, which led to the St. Paul's riot in Bristol in April 1980. 130 people were arrested, 25 taken to hospital, including 19 police and members of the press. Other similar upheavals were happening throughout the country. As stated in the song, the people getting angry. While listening to BBC Radio 1's single review programme, Roundtable, Dammers heard At The Club by Victor Romeo Evans. Impressed by the track's rootsy reggae sound, he decided to seek out its producer, John Collins. They asked if I would be interested in producing the specials. Suspicious it was some sort of joke, I nevertheless agreed to travel up to Coventry a couple of days later to meet the band, and I was surprised to find out that they were serious. They were surprised to find out that I was white. The initial sessions for the EP were held from the 3rd of April 1981 at the 8-track Woodbine Studios in Leamington Spa, a conscious step down from the 24-track Horizon Studios, where the specials had created more specials. Compared to the hyperactive rhythms present on other specials tracks, Ghost Town has a more sedate, spacious drums and bass, inspired by a 12-inch of Gregory Isaacs' Oh What a Feeling that Collins had brought in for reference. Being that Ghost Town didn't really start beyond a simple drum intro, Collins faded the track in under a sound effect, a technique that he'd previously used on At The Club B-side, Liftoff. He accomplished this using a kit-built Transcender 2000 synthesizer to create the ghostly sound effect at the start and the end of the song. While recording, Dammers still hadn't worked out where he wanted the backing vocals. As such, the backing vocal chant was recorded for the entirety of the song. This place is coming like a ghost town. So that Collins could mix it in whenever he needed. As Colin stated, by the time they got to the end of the track, "This Town Is Coming Like a Ghost Town" had become a hypnotic chant. During the Ghost Town sessions, members of the Specials were barely talking to each other. The previous 2 years touring and living on top of each other had caused a strain on their interpersonal relationships. Exacerbating the situation, Damas had instrumental parts pre-arranged, counter to their usual method of jamming out song ideas. As such, band members felt their input was unimportant and grew increasingly irritated by Damas' dominance on the track. So much so that guitarist Byers kicked a hole in the studio wall. Said Damas, "People weren't cooperating. I can remember walking out of a rehearsal in total despair because Neville would not try the ideas. You know, the brass bit is kind of jazzy, it has a discord. I remember Linville rushing into the control room while they were doing it, going, 'No, no, no, it sounds wrong, wrong, wrong.'"
And at number one, a great song, it's Ghost Town, The Specials.
The Ghost Town EP was released on the 12th of June, 1981, debuting at number 21. By the 11th of July, it had risen to number one, where it stayed for 3 weeks. The Specials were no strangers to chart success, as well as Gangsters' number six placing. Their Too Much Too Young live EP was the second ever EP to reach number one, as well as the first live release to top the charts since Chuck Berry's My Ding-a-ling in 1972. But Ghost Town was different. The week he got to number one in the UK charts, riots ripped right through the country. From Brixton in London to Handsworth in Birmingham, with disturbances happening in Manchester, Liverpool, Leeds and many other towns. The government had left the youth on the shelf, and they weren't going to take it silently anymore. Ghost Town getting to number one and remaining there showed how much Britain's state of unrest chimed with the song's content. Ghost Town wasn't just a catchy melody that had caught the public's ear. The Specials had summed up a moment in history in 3 minutes 40 seconds. The three major music publications in Britain at the time, The Enemy, Melody Maker and Sounds, all voted Ghost Town as the single of the year. Billy Bragg told The Guardian, "It's that classic no future nihilistic punk thing. Ghost Town might well have been the only punk number one." Though it's their greatest achievement, the song also marked the end for The Specials' original lineup. While waiting to play Ghost Town on Top of the Pops, Paul, Staple and Golding announced that they were leaving the band. Those lyrics about people getting angry and bands not wanting to play no more might as well have been about the members of The Specials. "We didn't talk to the rest of the guys. We couldn't even stay in the same dressing room. We couldn't even look at each other. We stopped communicating." You only realise what a genius Jerry was years later. At the time, we were on a different planet. Hall, Staple and Golding went on to form the new wave pop group Fun Boy Free soon after. While Damas continued with the remaining Specials as The Special AKA. Ghost Town has a special place in the British canon. Very few number ones have anything to say about how angry and pent up the UK populace is about any given time and situation. The only other single that's even close is the Sex Pistols' God Save the Queen, which got to number two the week of the Queen's Silver Jubilee. Ghost Town captured the moment, but in a way that took the political situation and boiled it down to the personal. This is not a song about Margaret Thatcher and her purges. It's a song about old women selling their homeware so they can eat. It's a song about your Friday night spot closing down. It's about people getting angry. And that sentiment is just as sharply relevant today as it was in 1981. That is Ghost Town's enduring legacy. Do you have a band? Want to release a song that captures a moment in history? Don't know how to get your message out there? Then why not check out Squarespace? Squarespace is a website building service that is ideal for independent businesses, like your band. As a band, with Squarespace, you'll be able to embed audio streams of your tracks directly onto your site with a beautifully integrated player and album art display. You can also set up an online shop for your digital and physical music. Squarespace makes the process of creating your own business website super simple. Not only are there templates, but they are easy to edit using responsive drag and drop tools. Let people know about your band with a Squarespace website. Head over to squarespace.com for a free trial. And when you're ready to launch, go to squarespace.com/trashtheory or use the offer code TRASHTHEORY to save 10% off your first purchase of a website or domain. Thanks for watching. What's your favourite UK number one and what did it say about its time and place? Be sure to like, comment and subscribe if you haven't already. As I usually do, I'd like to give a big shout out to all my supporters on Patreon. You're all awesome. Thank you, and I'll see you next time.